Yo, yo, yo.
I can't walk. I've been watching a lot of Watch Mojo top 10 lists lately, and they inspired me to do a top 5 list of my own because I'm a hack who can't come up with my own ideas.
You suck!
I understand there's a universally greatest of all time list for everything now, but this list is strictly my top 5 favorite comedians of my time.
Yeah!
I recognize Richard Pryor as the GOAT, but when he was in his prime, I was just sperm swimming in my dad's nutsack. As a kid in the 80s, I knew Richard Pryor more for movies like The Toy, Stir Crazy, and my favorite movie from him, Brewster's Millions, so he doesn't make this list. I also acknowledge Kevin Hart as the most popular comedian in the world right now, but he didn't make my top 5 neither.
Nigga!
I can listen to these kings of comedy talk about almost anything for hours on end today. I watched all of their meteoric rises to stardom throughout the years, and each of them earned my loyalty and respect with their unique jokes and delivery. I don't want to waste any more of your time, so let's get into the list.
I don't have some cool intro, so let's just get to the start of the show.
The first time I saw Bill Burr was on Chappelle's Show as a commentator on both the racial draft and the World Series of Dice, and he also played a corrupt cop in a Law & Order skit. I would show the Law & Order clip here, but Dave Chappelle doesn't want anyone to watch his show anymore because he doesn't get paid for it, so I'm gonna try to honor his wishes. I really started paying attention to Bill Burr after I saw his 2012 special, You People Are All the Same in the Same Year. His everyman approach to topics like women, politics, and religion immediately hooked me as a fan.
It ain't that what you say is how you say it. It's jokes. It's fun. But it's also the truth. In the back of your mind, you be wanting to say this shit sometime.
I really like his Boston accent because what he says just stings a little bit more with the way that he says them. Boston accents are so nice, I wish I could bang a chick from Boston.
Did you ever hear a Boston girl have an orgasm? Oh yeah! Oh yeah! Had it! Oh god, that was so good! Now I'm gonna stuff my fucking face with Pepperidge Farm!
Over time, as I watched more of his stand-up clips on YouTube, I learned even more about him. He's an alumnus of what I call the Comedy Cellar Crew, which consisted comedians Kevin Hart, Robert Kelly, not to be confused with R. Kelly, Colin Quinn, Patrice O'Neal, and probably more guys that I don't know or just forgot to mention.
Marijuana affects the memory.
With the exception of Kevin Hart, the Comedy Cellar Crew garnered a reputation of giving no fucks, and Bill Burr carries that same attitude into mainstream pop culture today. I don't agree with many of his critics who categorize his comedy as rage-filled humor. I'll admit that he's loud and abrasive, but that relentless passion to get his point across is what I love about him.
Yeah!
Instead, I agree with Wikipedia's description of his act as the loud guy at the bar with uninformed logic. I really enjoy how he'll spend up to what feels like 10 minutes making his case on a subject and then extend his proverbial olive branch to let the audience know that he's aware of the other side of his argument. Here's an example of one of those olive branches he extends in a joke he made about domestic violence.
Look, I realize I'm coming off pretty ignorant right about now. I realize that. Let me extend an olive branch then, okay? I realize that there's some animal guys out there, okay? Horrible guys, you know, have a rough day at the factory, come home, tuna casserole, and just start swinging, all right? I'm not trying to say that those people don't exist. I realize they exist, they should be buried underneath the prison, okay? So if I can admit that, ladies, can you at least admit that every ass kicking doesn't just fall out of the fucking sky?
It's hard for me to pick my favorite special from him, which makes him a great comic in my opinion. Personally, it feels like we're growing older together, and he's just clowning on the dumb shit that happens in the world along the way. Getting the recognition I feel he deserves with the success of his animated show, F is for Family on Netflix. His recurring role on the hit TV show The Mandalorian and hosting Saturday Night Live a couple of months ago, I hope this newfound Hollywood fame won't affect his edgy brand of comedy. If success doesn't water him down, I believe he has a chance to climb higher on my list, but he has some real competition ahead of him.
And that's all I have to say about that.
I think the first time I saw Chris Rock was in his screen-stealing scene in the movie I'm Gonna Get You, Sucker.
Let me get one.
Right on. One order.
One order of ribs.
No. One rib.
One rib.
I sure am hungry.
It feels like since I was 10 years old, Chris Rock was in everything I watched. From being the only person I can think of playing characters in both Saturday Night Live and in Living Color to his many cameo appearances in movies, I know Chris Rock paid his dues to be where he is today. I give credit to his portrayal of crackhead Pookie from New Jack City for keeping me off the pipe.
This crack shit, man, it's got me, man. I don't got no control over it, man. I try to kick, man. That shit just be calling me, man. Be calling me, man. I just gotta go to it. Need help, man.
Come on, man.
I love his style of comedy because he's the first black comic I can remember who was trying to teach me things while making me laugh other than... Not afraid to tell it like it is, Chris Rock will tell you the truth even if it hurts and have you laughing the entire time he states his case. I can appreciate the fact that in his jokes he designates accountability to all parties involved in them. As a black man, I believe the greatest joke he ever told was Black People vs. Niggas in his second stand-up special, Bring the Pain, in 1996. Obviously, in the bit he explains the differences between regular black people and niggas, but the joke gets better with age because I've grown up to witness and experience both sides of it. I first heard it when I was 18, and at almost 43 years of age, I still think it's
hilarious.
YouTube denied me access to a clip of that joke, so I suggest you check it out for yourself after you're done watching, liking, and subscribing to this video first.
I ain't too proud to beg for your money, so like, share, and subscribe.
I love the plots to the movies he come out with, but I'll admit sometimes the execution is lacking. Head of State and CB4 definitely top my favorite Chris Rock movies for sure. I'm playing Rough Riders Anthem by DMX right now, so you know I gotta play this clip from Down to Earth where Chris plays a black man who dies and gets reincarnated as a rich white man.
Stop, drop, shut him down, open up shop. Niggas wanna try, what? Niggas wanna die, what? Niggas wanna why, what? Niggas wanna die. All I feel is pain, all I feel is rain.
How can I maintain, what? With that shit on my brain,
what?
I resort to violence,
what?
My niggas moving silent,
what?
Like you don't know what I style,
what?
New York niggas the wildest,
what?
My niggas
with
it,
what?
You want it, come and get it,
what?
Took it, then we split it.
Like Bill Burr, I can't pick a favorite special from him neither, which also makes him a great comic as well. Chris Rock is an institution of comedy based off his consistency and longevity. Achieving all the highs a comedian can wish for from TV and movies through stand-up, it seems Chris is gonna test his talents in the horror movie genre like Jordan Peele. As a Chris Rock fan of over 30 years, I can't wait to see it happen.
And that's all I have to say about that.
In my eyes, Eddie Murphy was the undisputed king of pop culture comedy in the 80s. From the legendary characters he portrayed on Saturday Night Live to his performances in classic comedy movies that helped define the decade, Eddie is third on my list with only two stand-up specials under his credit. The historical significance and impact of those two specials are what makes Eddie Murphy so important to me.
Yeah!
In his first special, Delirious, in 1983, it felt like Eddie was a kid with a bazooka given permission to blow up any and everything in his sights. Saying the words fuck 230 times and shit 171 times, calling Delirious profane would be an understatement. In hindsight, Delirious seems like Eddie Murphy's comedic genius in its adolescent phase, telling jokes about his childhood and family life mixed with some content that would simply be deemed highly offensive and unacceptable today. Dressed in an all-red leather suit for the performance, Eddie brought a certain rock star element to the show that black comedy had never seen before. Delirious was a huge success that was originally aired as an HBO special, so Eddie had to up the ante for a second one. In 1987, Raw was released in movie theaters everywhere, becoming the highest-grossing stand-up comedy concert film of all time at the box office, making $50.5 million in the United States and Canada.
Yeah.
This time in a purple leather suit, Eddie stood before the world as a man and master of his craft. I was almost 10 years old when I saw Raw for the first time, so I remember finding only half the show funny because I wasn't fucking yet. Losing my virginity and getting into and out of relationships with chicks gave me the life experience needed to understand the dating advice portion of the show. Enjoying the special with all the puzzle pieces filled in for over 20 years now, I can say with no hesitation that Raw is a masterpiece that I feel cannot be topped, even by Eddie Murphy himself. People want Eddie to come back to stand-up, but I don't. Why not, Chucky? Selfishly, I think it would be like Michael Jordan when he came out of retirement to play for the Washington Wizards. Yeah, Jordan put up all-star numbers during the comeback, but he wasn't dominating the NBA like he did in the 90s. I feel if Eddie came back to stand-up, he would be really good but not as great as he was. To use another sports analogy, I think Eddie should just leave that memory of his World Series walk-off home run in the minds of his
millions
of fans to appreciate, because you're only as good as your last performance, and a comeback would only downplay the greatness of Raw moving forward. Personally, I feel Eddie Murphy's talents are best served in movies, and he has many classics under his belt. Coming to America is easily my favorite movie from him, and I can't wait for the sequel that's coming out on Amazon Prime March 5th. Dolomite's My Name proves to me that he still got it as far as movies are concerned, and I'll be patiently waiting to see what other surprises Eddie Murphy has in store for us.
And that's all I have to say about that.
At some point during the past decade, I heard kids describe everything as savage, which annoyed the fuck out of me, by the way. Patrice O'Neal was the embodiment of a savage when he was alive. The most feared member of the Comedy Cellar crew would mercilessly roast you and whoever was dumb enough to try to help you gang up on him. Patrice would even roast other comedians if he thought,
"Man, you corny!"
Patrice didn't have TV shows or movies he starred in because he refused to tap dance for the people that run Hollywood. So why does he rank so high on my list? Elephant in the Room, the only hour-long special to his credit, is absolutely hands down my favorite stand-up show of all time. I've seen that show so many times I had to go down YouTube's rabbit hole of Patrice O'Neal footage to learn more about him. He wasn't a very popular comic because of his lack of exposure in mainstream pop culture, so in a lot of his stand-up clips, he tells the same jokes.
"I killed so hard, I was scared I was gonna be famous and shit. And then it didn't happen like I wanted it to happen. And I got disappointed, and I said, fuck it. I'ma just do what I do, which is why motherfuckers don't know me from a goddamn hole." You heard the claps. Roseanne, wow! 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 We should be wooing.
His appearances on Tough Crowd with Colin Quinn proved to me that Patrice was a cut above the rest of the comics who acquired fame before him. Tough Crowd with Colin Quinn was basically a continuation of Politically Incorrect with Bill Maher and a predecessor to Real Time with Bill Maher, where the guests were comedians discussing hot topics in politics and pop culture. Comics who made appearances with prepared material would get called out and roasted by Patrice, who genuinely spoke from the heart at all times on the show.
"Wear another earring, we'll forget you're 60. Oh,
Jesus Christ.
Get away from me, fat black man! Patrice is Jewish.
Gorillas in the mist. That's done.
After many hilarious appearances on the Opie and Anthony show, Patrice O'Neal started his own podcast, The Black Phillip Show, where he would constantly give advice on how men should deal with women. He also had a show on VH1 called Web Junk, which was basically ripped off by Tosh.0. His Elephant in the Room special was so successful, it seemed like Hollywood was ready to give Patrice a chance at stardom as he made what I believe his final TV appearance on the roast of Charlie Sheen.
I respect Charlie Sheen, I do. I say yes because I respect, not his body of work, like not... It's all been very Christian Slayer-ish, like it just like... He sucks, but he's good, but he sucks at the same time.
Losing his battle with diabetes at age 41 in 2011, I believe Patrice would have became a star. Kevin Hart and Bill Burr openly admit that they feared getting roasted by Patrice, which is really saying something in my eyes. Patrice would always tell people his truth, whether they liked it or not.
That I love being able to say anything I want. Mm-hmm. I had to learn to stop caring about people not laughing. Because the idea of comedy, really, is not everybody should be laughing.
Right.
It should be about 50 people laughing and 50 people horrified.
Right. Like,
you know what I mean? It's supposed to be people that get it and people that don't get it.
If there's a heaven for a gangster, I believe Patrice O'Neal is up there making everybody laugh right now. I miss you so much, Patrice, and I hope you rest in peace.
You're El Negro. I like your styles, huh?
And that's all I have to say about that.
The first time I saw Dave Chappelle was in 1996 in The Nutty Professor as Reggie, the insult comic who roasted the fuck out of Eddie Murphy, who plays Sherman Klump's fat ass.
Oh, look at this, is with a woman too. Oh, no. Who is sucking whose titties over here?
In 1998, I saw my favorite stoner movie of all time, Half Baked, and that shit changed my life. I could just insert a couple of clips of my favorite quotes here, but I'm not gonna do that. Instead, I'm just gonna say this weed was the shiznittle bam snip snap sabby. Special shout out to Steven Wright, who played the guy on the couch from this disabled guy on his couch. Killing Them Softly, Chappelle Show, and For What It's Worth are etched into my memory forever. He left $50 million on the table because he felt like Comedy Central was trying to fuck him, so he left for Africa. Comedy Central got pissed, so they spread a rumor that Dave Chappelle
was on crack!
Oprah asked Dave,
"You smoke crack, don't you?"
Dave said no and gave Oprah's audience a peek into the apparently twisted world we know as Hollywood. He took like a 5-year vacation, sporadically giving shows in obscure and random locations while the world became more sensitive around him. Netflix signed Dave Chappelle for $1,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000 I respect and cherish everything he's done throughout the arc of the story I just told you, but what makes him my favorite comic of all time is what he's currently doing with his fame moving forward. Dave uses his stand-up now just to talk to us because he knows we need to hear it. He's gonna tell it to us like it is through wonderfully crafted jokes that challenge our beliefs with the swagger of Bugs Bunny.
What's up, Doc?
In my opinion, comedy needs a leading voice of reason right now, and I can't think of anyone else who can do it better than Dave Chappelle. Historically, I think Dave is chasing legends to eventually become the greatest to ever do it, but that's just me.
And that's all I have to say about that.
This is easily the longest video I've ever made, and I'd like to thank you so much for watching the whole way through. If you enjoyed the video, hit the like button, please subscribe, and let me know what you think in the comment section below.
Peace. I'm Audi 5000.
video. But then again, what do I know? I'm just an old crippled bastard.
I ain't too proud to beg for your money, so like, share, and subscribe.